Congresswoman Marie Newman represents Illinois' 3rd Congressional District. This is, I believe, your first term, and you are supported by Howie Klein, and you are also supported by Bernie Sanders, as well as Elizabeth Warren and Mayor Lightfoot. Howie, please introduce Congresswoman Marie Newman.
Well, Congresswoman Marie Newman has been someone who came to the party making a bunch of promises about how progressive she's going to be. And guess what? She is now the number one most progressive member of Congress, according to Progressive Punch. She has the highest vote score of anyone in Congress. There can only be one number one. That's who we're talking to today. Wow. So I wanted to ask Congresswoman Newman about and she's being challenged by a corporate Democrat, a new Dem, who's trying to get her seat.
Is this Lipinski?
No, not a Lipinski again. There's someone like him. It's a guy named Sean Casten, who's got tons of corporate money behind him and ideological conservative money behind him. I mean, they're taking an opportunity to try to go after Congresswoman Newman, because he's not a progressive and doesn't support the Green New Deal and doesn't support Medicare for all, and he's pretty awful. But I wanted to ask you about this, Congresswoman Newman. I know you don't take corporate PAC money. Does Casten take corporate PAC money?
Yeah, he's taken about $1 million in corporate PAC money just in the last couple of years. So it's really significant. And it's from, it's funny, it centers in three bad buckets, right? Our three top enemies: oil and energy companies, healthcare, insurance, pharma, and a fourth bad bucket. And he sits on financial services. So,
wow.
Not great.
Well, that explains why he hasn't endorsed the Green New Deal or Medicare for all. He's taking money from the people that don't want that to happen.
Yeah. He doesn't even support carbon pricing. Just so you know, so when he talks about that he's a climate hawk, I laugh so hard. It's so hilarious.
Well, he first ran as that. He was like some kind of an environmental entrepreneur, and he that helped him to get into Congress originally. And then once he got into Congress, he did the opposite of what you did. He just became more and more bought out and conservative. And I mean, it's pretty easy to support the Green New Deal at this point, and he absolutely refuses. But I wanted to ask you about when you're campaigning in the district, mm-hmm. do the constituents know about him? Do they understand the difference between someone who takes corporate money and someone who doesn't? Or is it just like, something they don't get?
Yeah, I would say that in the district, people are not necessarily aware that he takes a ton of corporate cash. And, remember, they blended about half of my district with five other districts, right? And one fifth of that five group is Sean's district was incredibly wealthy, affluent. He was a weirdly good match for that district. Now the district is half my district and then an amalgamation of others. He's completely ill-fitting because he likes talking to rich people and talking about rich people things. And that's what he does. And so he's not a great fit anymore. But in my part of the district, people hate it when you take PAC money because they know that it handcuffs you and then you're required to stay within these rules. Whereas when you don't take corporate money, you are free to be in alignment with your district and vote your district. And so the answer is they're starting to understand that, but that takes education, and we've been pounding that drum really hard and people are starting to understand, but not as many as I would like.
Right. Well, I mean, I guess what they when you tie it to policies that are popular, like the Green New Deal or Medicare for All, and you say, why hasn't he supported these things? Why isn't he a co-sponsor of any of this? I guess that, and then you tie that to the money, I guess then that helps them to understand. Now, he's got a lot more money than you do.
Yeah. I agree with you. That does work. We've been very clear that the throughput line, it's very linear. It's like when you take money from all of these health insurance companies and you don't support Medicare for All, very clear. When you take money from BP, Chevron, Exelon, and all of these other energy companies, and you never say that they price gouge, you never go after them, and I go after them all day long. There's a reason, right? You know, and he thinks our only tool in our climate toolbox are rebates and dividends. He thinks those are our only tools. So he's a cap and trade guy. Sure. Which among the 74 other things we can do, I don't have an issue with, honestly. Like, do everything all day long. But to call the Green New Deal and the Thrive Agenda impractical and what else does he call it, naive, is ridiculous. The Thrive Agenda is the actualization of the Green New Deal into money buckets and specific actions that will mitigate and get us to our emissions reductions goals. So it's really, the level of hypocrisy is astonishing to me.
Can you explain the Thrive Agenda? I don't know that everybody knows what that is exactly.
Yeah. So the Thrive Agenda was built to kind of actualize and operationalize our Green New Deal. So it takes the premise of the Green New Deal that we want to be reduce emissions by 50% by 2035, some say 2040, some say 2050, and actually puts it into buckets like mitigating lead pipes, addressing polluters in a very real way where we are actually punishing them and stopping them and putting them out of business. Making our two biggest culprits, we all know this, 40% of all emissions come from buildings and construction, and the other 35% comes from transit, right? So in the Thrive Agenda, it would allocate to electrifying and putting renewables into all of our transit systems, doing like what is the equivalent of a wartime production methodology around electrification of all vehicles. By the way, our vehicle manufacturers are ready to do this. The problem actually is the gas and oil companies won't refuse to cooperate. Our auto manufacturers are ready to go on this. But also in the Thrive Agenda are specific strategies around how we completely rehabilitate affordable housing with green housing, that we address transit systems housing together because they are so integrally tied. So this is it's a really robust plan that actualizes the Green New Deal. And so to not agree with those things is egregious.
Yes. But when you're out in your district explaining it to the voters, do you ever get any pushback saying that, look, you have the White House, you have the House of Representatives, you have the Senate, And you haven't done any of this stuff. Why should we give you another? Why should we give the Democrats another term?
You know what? I'm lucky in my district. So the new district that I'm running in, which is the new Illinois 6, it's basically an open seat in many ways because it's a brand new district in Illinois. They're still willing to support us. Democrats are Democrats. Even most independents are supporting. It's a D7 district. And people are still willing to support us. I don't have as much pushback on that, but people do say it. And you know what they're right is that, look, we didn't get Build Back Better done. We didn't make sure that child tax credits stay in place, universal child care, help for in-home health care and all of those folks. Like, this is their complaint is absolutely legitimate. But we do have to say, you know what, we got the Infrastructure Act together, which wasn't as climate friendly as we wanted to, but it's still, doing a lot around bringing down emissions in the transit agencies and mitigating lead pipes and the like. So not perfect. And look, I rail on this every day, you know, so we need to do more. That's right. But in my district, they are understanding that, look, you got some pretty big things done, but you didn't get the largest thing that we wanted done, which was climate action and child tax credits, universal child care, all of those things in PPP.
And what about reducing the price of pharmaceuticals and raising the minimum wage? Are you finding people saying, why didn't you guys get that done?
Yeah. Now, I think what, you know, this new tap, but you've seen this, right, that we passed insulin $35 per month cap. And I think that that's a good thing. And that's a good starting point. But and Republicans still voted against it. It is unbelievable. Right. People are still asking for a reduction in prices. And honestly, I'm still of the mindset that let's do Medicare for all and do this in a way where we put it in chunks. So the first chunk should be, hey, Medicare is available to everybody over 55. We reduce the top 35 drugs. We add vision, dental, hearing, long-term health care. Roll that out. Year later, roll out to the next group and to vulnerable populations and on and get this thing done. We have the infrastructure to do this. Let's just do it. Let's move it. This is honestly, as we all know on this call, Medicare for all would be far easier to implement than Obamacare was. Obamacare was creating a whole new structural system, and Medicare for all is already in place.
Right, because it's just adding to Medicare.
Yeah, it's just.
But then you've got Republicans, and conservative Democrats who are standing in the way.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's the answer? I mean, I'm worried because as bad as I think Pelosi has been, and I'm not saying she's terrible, but she hasn't been good on a lot of these things. What I see coming down the pike is much, much worse. And it worries me. I even see progressives saying that they are getting behind Hakeem Jeffries. Hakeem Jeffries isn't going to be on our side on any issues. Anyway, sorry to bring that up to you.
No, I don't think that, I don't know. I mean, I obviously have not personally talked to Madam Speaker and find out if she's running again or if she's wanting to be Speaker again. I absolutely have no idea. I mean, she'll win her election, but I have no idea if she has interest in, and who knows, maybe she steps down, who knows, a million different things could happen. And there's four or five people that would vie for that position. So is Hakeem the front runner? I actually don't know. I don't sense that there is a front runner right now.
Oh, well, good. We're better off without a front runner because, you know, I mean, I don't see any real strong progressives getting ready to run for that. I've been, you know, begging Pramila to do it. And she just sort of, you know, sort of pushes me away.
Can I ask you about Nina Turner? And were you surprised that the Congressional Progressive Caucus, the Democratic Progressive Caucus, didn't endorse Nina Turner? Why didn't they?
Yeah, I guess in the charter, and I have not obviously read our charter, I'll be honest with you. In our CPC charter, we don't go against incumbents. So not great. I think that, honestly, there's a bunch of rules in Congress that are beyond ridiculous, and that's one of them. You know, because I'm in an incumbent on incumbent race, and now the CPC caucus actually has endorsed me over Sean, which is good, right? but
did they endorse you when you were running against Lipinski? I know that Pelosi didn't, Madam Speaker.
No, the caucus, that was another rule in their charter that they couldn't endorse against an incumbent within a primary. Right. But I'm endorsed this time and happy with that. And, you know, but I got to say, if I was Nina Turner, I might be a little upset.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, she's a lot upset. I talked to her about it. She was really, really upset.
Yeah.
And I don't blame her. And a lot of people are very upset. And people are looking at the Congressional Progressive Caucus with new eyes now and mostly a lot of anger because, you know, that the woman who they did endorse is a new Dem. How does the Progressive Caucus endorse a new Dem over Nina?
She is a part of the progress. She was accepted into the Progressive Caucus too. So she was endorsed she was accepted into the Progressive Caucus and then endorsed by CPC. So that happened.
How do you get into the caucus?
You have to be voted in. You present your credentials and your voting record. And, you know, and I believe Chantel did vote progressively on many things. Again, it's the charter rules around the caucus, and Pramila would know more about that than I do. But, you know, following the charter rules, apparently,
Right.
Yeah, well, then I guess they need to be changed. You're an officer of the CPC. So anyway. Now, what about Chantel, by the way? Is she a co-sponsor of the Green New Deal and the Medicare for All?
I think she recently did sign on to Medicare for All. I think that's recent.
Can I ask you about Build Back Better? Do you mind?
Go right ahead.
When President Biden was running for office, he knew who Joe Manchin was and Kyrsten Sinema and Tester and Warner. Why didn't he have a plan? He knew that these people in the Senate were going to block Build Back Better. Do we have pork barrel spending to buy these votes? Seems to me Lyndon Johnson would have said to Joe Manchin, there's going to be a university named after you in West Virginia, and these little boys and girls are going to go to this university every day and see your name, and they're going to remember Joe Manchin forever.
Yeah.
What happened to that? What happened to pork barrel spending and earmarks?
So I think that there's not a lot to get, and that may not be important to Manchin. Like, weirdly, that may have been important to politicians in a bygone era, but that may, because honestly, I don't know Manchin, so I couldn't tell you what's important to him. His coal company is important to him, is what's important to him.
Isn't it the responsibility of the Democratic leadership to find out what's important to Joe Manchin and give it to him so we can have universal preschool and free tuition? Isn't that the job of the Democratic leadership to figure out how to get these people on board?
Honestly, I do think that the president tried to negotiate that way and find something that was very important to him, and he just couldn't get there. Beyond his coal company, there's not a lot Joe cares about. I mean, Manchin doesn't care about a whole lot.
But if you're the president and you know that you're going to be president and you know who Joe Manchin is, shouldn't you have had a plan for this before you decided to run for office?
And I think he did. And I think that the tables kept look in the last, probably 2 months of the negotiation, Manchin and Sinema, they'd have a deal. Literally, they'd have a deal. They'd call us on a Friday night and tell the caucus that we've got the deal. Here it is. Here are the line items. And literally by Monday morning, Manchin would call the president back and say, you know, I don't like it now. Literally.
Right. But I don't understand. I'll move on. I just don't understand. We know that you need... It's below the belt. It's politics. It's rough and tumble. Why? You're the most powerful man in the world, and you're going to let a backwater senator manipulate the process? It seems to me you have a lot of arrows in your quiver that you could use if you really wanted Build Back Better, right?
Yeah, and I think that, I agree with a whole lot with the president, and there's things that we don't agree on, right? And there's just things that I'm not privy to. I'll just be honest with you. Like, you know, when Pramila was leading the way with Build Back Better and negotiating directly with Manchin and Sinema and those folks, she made a lot of headway. In fact, now we hear that the Build Back Better bill will probably live in three buckets and we'll get something done. Now Manchin is interested in climate action. If he can get leases to be executed, which takes 7 years, and honestly, give him a few and then we'll pull him back. You know, like, talk about rough and tumble. It's like, okay, say yes and then say no.
But before I turn it back to Howie, I have one question. Why can't I read transcripts from congressional hearings? When there is a hearing, all I get from the committee website are the prepared statements, but the back and forths, you cannot read a transcript of the hearings. You have to go through the congressional printing office if they ever decide to print it. Is that on purpose? Is there a reason we cannot read transcripts of hearings?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I'm on two major committees, and I don't see why you shouldn't be able to. I wasn't aware of that you couldn't get beyond the prepared remarks, because the prepared remarks are available to everybody. I know that. But the, you know, the unprepared remarks, I wasn't aware that you couldn't answer.
Well, it's a for-profit business. I've looked into it. So C-SPAN, which runs advertising now, by the way, they have closed captioning, but you cannot download the closed captioning and read the hearings. And if you want a printed transcript or an online PDF, you have to go through the Congressional Printing Office. It's business. There are companies now that charge for these transcripts.
That's ridiculous. I did not know that. Well, first of all, I didn't know C-SPAN was now advertising. That's kind of kooky too. But no, that's very interesting. I did not know that. And I don't have an answer for you on that.
Howie?
I'm in California. We put a huge amount of money into having a bullet train and nothing has happened. Now, you're on the transportation committee, right?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, and I read somewhere that you're a big proponent of bullet trains, right? Or at least for your own district.
I speak real. Yeah, I think that because two reasons. One is that it would begin to reduce emissions and that we can electrify them. So it's, or they can be other modes of renewables. So I'm a fan.
So why hasn't anything been done? I never could understand that. I mean, yeah. California spent that much money, and all we got were a bunch of studies.
Yeah. So there's three corridors they're looking at for high speed rail. So when I brought Buttigieg in over the summer, I asked him for a pilot here, and they are assessing that. So there may be a pilot from Cleveland to Chicago, and then one that would extend to DC and New York. So those long-term bullet trains would be very, very effective, and that is under consideration. So do know that from the DOT budget, that actually is under consideration. There will be pilots. We just haven't determined where they're going to be yet.
Right. You would think.
And is this a bipartisan thing?
Yeah, no, I mean, honestly, they're in California and in Texas. I know the Republicans don't like the high speed rail projects that have gone up because they haven't been perfect. And I've got news for everybody. Newer technologies, newer processes, new programs are never perfect and they don't work very well sometimes. So you do have to stay at it. As I remind everybody, you know what? Social Security didn't work real well the first few years. Welfare didn't work very well the first few years. Every program we've had didn't work real well the first few years. So you have to address it, but it doesn't mean that you walk away from it. So
you voted against funding, or at least American funding, Israel's Iron Dome, which is able to shoot down primitive missiles coming from Hamas. I believe Raytheon help design Iron Dome and probably gets a piece of it. Does Iron Dome work? Do the Patriot missiles work? Are we able to shoot missiles out of the sky, or is this just a dream?
So the Iron Dome has been somewhat effective. And just to be clear, I want to break that down for everybody why I voted against it. So, first and foremost, we have built that technology in a joint way, and it's Raytheon and several other private enterprises worked with both countries, Israel and the U.S. We made a commitment to pay for certain parts of it to Israel. We met that commitment in the NDAA appropriations bill. I voted yes for that because there was an increase in military personnel salaries. So I said yes to that. Otherwise, I would have voted against the NDAA because it made the DOD budget higher than it's ever been, which is ridiculous.
That's the Defense Authorization Act, and the DOD is the Department of Defense.
Right. So with that, when Iron Dome came up and asked for $1 billion more, because we made our commitment in the appropriations budget, we'd paid them that, we're all good, like peace out, right? So when the Iron Dome vote was carved out and said, hey, Israel's asking for $1 billion more beyond the commitment that we already kept for them and paid, I said no for five reasons. One is labor was mad about it. They said, hey, you're going to spend $1 billion on a defense mechanism that you've already paid for. No, that should be paid on that should be going to either construction or green jobs, whatever. And then the peace folks in my district, or anti-military apparatus increases, said no. There were gun safety groups that said no. There were churches that said no, and rank and file folks that said no. So this was one of those situations where, because I'm very in touch with my district, all of those groups are like, no, ma'am. I said, well, then I'm going to vote my district and say no, ma'am. And then obviously the Palestinian rights folks, which is a strong contingency, and they said no. So this was not a like me pulling it out of the sky and taking a chance on a vote. It just, my district did not want it. So we said no.
Does it work? Can we shoot a missile out of the sky? Because we're planting Patriot missiles in Poland and around Europe.
Yeah.
And they work.
They work?
They may not have a perfect score, but yes, yeah. They work.
It works somewhat, and it's the best that we have, basically. But let me just add one thing to it. So I want to be clear on what happened recently that few people know about, is that the Ukrainians, so President Zelensky went to Israel 6-8 months ago, knowing that he was going to be in this conflict. Clearly, he knew that. And asked Israel, hey, can we have some of the technology and help us build this? And they said, no. So it's okay. And remember, President Zelensky is Jewish, has relatives in Israel, the whole deal. So it was one of these, the hypocrisy of the Israelis sometimes is.
But Israel is trying to remain neutral because there are a couple hundred thousand Jews still in Russia.
That's right.
So it's a balancing act. And
it really is. But
Bennett is meeting with Putin, the Israeli prime minister. Tried some shuttle diplomacy with Putin. Is Biden going to do any shuttle diplomacy with Putin?
Well, there's diplomacy going on all the time. Don't mistake that there's not big shows of, you know, them meeting on a rock somewhere in Asia or in Europe. You know,
Do you get a sense that President Biden, who I voted for, and I would vote for him again, do you get a sense that he wants to have it out with Putin in Ukraine? That this is something he would prefer to have a proxy war with Putin in Ukraine and have it break him, kind of like Zbigniew Brzezinski tricking the Soviets into invading Afghanistan.
I think that
I don't know that they tricked anybody into invading Afghanistan. Once they were in Afghanistan, the U.S. did everything it could to bleed Russia and just make it more and more horrible. But I don't think the U.S. encouraged them to invade Afghanistan.
Actually, Brzezinski takes credit for he was Carter's national security advisor, and he takes credit for tricking the Soviets into getting into a Vietnam-like quagmire in Afghanistan. And I can't help but wonder if Jake Sullivan, our national security advisor, and Tony Blinken, our secretary of state, think they're tricking Putin into quicksand, Ukrainian quicksand.
No, I think that's a war.
He's not on a war. I want to be clear. President Biden does not want to put troops on the ground anywhere. He is very.
But I'm talking about funding. You know, instead of going with diplomacy, he's giving weapons instead of olive branches.
Well, that's part of our commitment.
Russia invaded Ukraine before Biden was president. I mean, Crimea was taken over when Obama was president. And that, I mean, you know, that's part of the same war. I mean, we may not see it that way, but the Russians and the Ukrainians do.
It's a slow beat, but to be clear, so, and I just want to go back a minute, and I want to roll back the tape a little bit. So, with regard to Ukraine and NATO and President Biden's posture, let's be very clear. Everybody's furious. The president's furious. Blinken's, everybody's furious. Had we not, I also want to give the Biden administration some credit here. Had we not been working for 6 months prior to the incursion and this unprovoked war, had we not been working on coordinated sanctions, they would not have happened as swiftly and clearly as they have. We have disempowered something like 50 to 60% of of their economy right now. So it is effective. Is it a slow methodology? Yes, it is. But had we not done that work with our partners across the world, we would not be in this position. It would be far worse. It's horrifying to watch. I can't tell you. It's like watching, just hundreds of thousands of people die in slow motion. It is a horrifying thing to watch.
So there should be a peace movement.
We should. And just know, and I think you all know this, no one's naive on this call, that peace discussions and peace talks are like this, right? They go up and down and in and out and all over the place. It is not a linear line. So those discussions are taking place at all times in different ways. It's just that we have to figure out how to give Putin some level of out here. And that's just forever the process of those peace talks is like, how do we give him an off ramp where he's still doesn't look like an absolute fool. But just know that the sanctions are working very effectively, very effectively.
Marie, before we say goodbye, there's one other question I wanted to ask you. You fought really hard for two cycles to get into Congress. You defeated an incumbent, which is really, really difficult to do. Now that you're in Congress, what do you feel was the thing that you accomplished that made it worthwhile? Was there something, was there like one particular thing that is important enough for you to have sacrificed so much of your life to get in there?
I would say there's two big buckets for me. One is that in Congress, being part of the Progressive Caucus and making kind of every bill more progressive, and we have in many ways, those are the invisible things that we don't see every day. And then there's a series of what I call hole pluggers that I put together, which is the Matt Holler bill, which would require ETO, which is a carcinogen that's banned in Australia and Europe, introduced. So it would be stopping that toxin and many other hole plugger bills, reducing taxes for micro businesses and making sure that immigrants and people of color are first in line with access to capital and small businesses. It is all of those things. And then most importantly, convening people in my district and gluing everybody back together so that all the electeds, all the community leaders are talking and getting things done. On the unsexy topics like train delays and flooding and all those things that no one seems to care about, but I do. So we did a lot in a very short amount of time, and it brought $240 million to the district in 10 months. And my predecessor, it took 16 years to bring $300 million to the district. So, it's about fighting and advocating for your folks. And I think that I advocated in a way that's really strong. And I will tell you, I think that I'm going to win this race probably by a very small amount. But if I don't win for some reason, it just means that God had a different plan for me to advocate because I'm not going
to
stop.
How do people donate to you? How do people donate?
Oh, you're so kind. The name of my website is marienewmanforcongress.com.
marienewmanforcongress.com. And go give money to Marie Newman. She's endorsed by Howie Klein. That's all you need to know. That's the truth. If she's endorsed by Howie Klein, we donate money. Give whatever you can, as long as you're an American citizen or have a green card, and give $5, $500. I don't think you can. I don't think you can give more than the
individual amount, which is a lot of money. So no one should. It shouldn't be a hardship for everybody. I tell people that all the time. If it's a hardship, keep your money. But if you can spare any money, we deeply appreciate it. I'm up against a corporate dem that has $2 million on me. But the top amount that an individual can give is $2,900. But if you've got $2, God bless you and I love you.
Right. Listen, we've been talking about Howard Schultz cracking down on the Starbucks people trying to go union. You might want to think twice about your mochaccino and give it to Congresswoman Marie Newman instead. Howie, you're breaking up for some reason. Are you there?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah, I can't. Howie broke up. I apologize. Howie Klein, thank you so much for introducing us to Congress Congresswoman Marie Newman, and I know how hard it is to get elected to Congress. I don't know how hard it is, but it is, and you took on a powerful machine, the Lipinski machine, and I will do anything I can to help you win and go back to Congress. Once again, what is your website, please?
It's MarieNewmanForCongress.com.
MarieNewmanForCongress.com. Everybody go right now to MarieNewmanForCongress.com and donate what you can. You'll feel better, I promise you. Thank you, Howie. Thank you, Congresswoman.
Thank you so much, and everybody be well.
You too.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Howie.